Thank you. Thank you, Sudha. Yeah. So the idea is the beneficiary is what we are talking about, to empower the high school children, because we started the biotech program under CBSE in 2002. So we have a whole bunch of children who have gone to higher studies, and many of them are very keen to do biotech at school level. And, you know, Professor Muralidhar also, as part of NCERT curriculum, has introduced a lot of biotechnology portions into bioscience portions. We find that there is a whole bunch of people who are very excited about biotechnology. Then there are so many bachelor's program, whether it's BSc or BTech, MSc or MTech, PhD. Then a lot of postdocs are around. A lot of people have become faculty members. Some of them are school teachers. With them all, I have had opportunity to interact. So is Professor Sitaramam and Professor Muralidhar. What services we thought we will provide is, one is professional development. And who will be the beneficiary? It will be the biotechnology students and faculty. Another is framing research proposals, so we can help the faculty, postdoc, and project students. Because many of them, when they come to final year and they have to do a project, children are roaming around where to do, because some of them say they have to do outside. With the resources we have, the network we have, we should be able to help some of the children to find a suitable place and suitable area which they want to work on, hopefully make their connection. So that is also another major activity of the KK Biotech. And you will see that we have a lot of consultants with them, which you must go to the kkbiotech.net site and have a look at who are the members. And Dr. Sudha Rao is one of our key members, along with her husband, Dr. Raja Mogase Mangalam. And they are all people who have taken risk into venturing into becoming an entrepreneur. And, you know, they are unique kind of entrepreneurs in the sense that they publish papers, you know, they help institutions to work with them and help them to interpret data. They have done a whole lot of yeoman service into the whole thing. Probably they have more than 5,000 publications in association with many universities. So they did a unique model. That's why I'm very happy that both of them are part of our this thing. We also have a, so if you go through that site, you will see we have social entrepreneur. He was a boy who did PhD, and he was our student during the undergraduation days. Today, he has started a foundation called Connecting Dreams Foundation. When you go through our website, you can read more about him. That will give you an idea how biotech students have diversified into various areas. Then I have my old friend, Rama Subramaniam there, who is a food technologist. He was my batchmate in college days. And he helps people to set up the food industry. Very experienced in the whole thing. We have our former alumni from IP University, who recently bagged about $4 million to start creating cell culture to produce meat in Switzerland. So he has started his own company, and I request you to go through that. Similarly, I have one of my, Professor Muralidhar student, Amit Bhattacharya, probably, I don't know whether he remembers him. He also does a lot of optical devices to take images, etc. Now, you might say, why my other favorite students are not there? Unfortunately, they are all working in government institutions, and they have a problem of securing permission to join. So they are unable to officially this thing. But KK Biotech will tie up with their institution so that we could have their services coming. Let me tell you, Sudha Rao and husband Raja also would love to have internship student, and you can work out some very interesting thing. You must look into that possibility. Then we have one Surya Narayanan, who has been in the stem cell based industry for the last 14 years. And about to finish his PhD. He knows a whole lot of things, and I suggest you go through this thing, the website. So generally, I would say that give you an idea of flavor of people we have who can help you, and they all are very keen to help. Of course, the mentors are there in Professor Muralidhar and Professor Sitaraman, whom I always take for granted. I don't even ask them that you have to do it. And let me tell you that Sitaraman, I was discussing, statistics is one of the weak subjects which we have not strengthened in our universities. And so Professor Sitaraman has agreed to do a hands-on workshop online to help you understand. So a lot of activities are planned under the KK Biotech banner. Another issue is the post-COVID curriculum restructuring and new education policy, because as you know, COVID has upset a lot of things. So we could help many of them with, help them to restructure their program. And since I have a lot of experience in technology transfer, how to adapt the foreign technologies to Indian condition, so we can always help you, the startups and medium, small and micro enterprises in the country. So it just gives you an idea that KK Biotech wants to inspire, as you can see in the logo, ideate and implement. And thanks to my network of students and my mentors, I think we will certainly be able to help all of you whosoever is interested to achieve that. So, that's a slide. Sorry. And that's a slide. So I just want to start now with the main talk. If you look at biochemistry, before biochemistry came into scene,
we cannot see your slides.
Okay, let me just see.
Yeah, you have to present and focus on the screen, sir. Use the present now option.
Present now option. Enga irukku?
Keela. It's at the bottom.
Yeah.
You click on that and you then move to the window that you want to present.
More screen sharing. Screen sharing option is also okay.
One minute. Let me, I'll just shut it down and get back to the. Just give me 1 minute. Sorry. Yeah.
The present now button is on your bottom right.
Bottom right.
Shut it down.
Which one?
Shut down.
Yeah.
Present now.
Oh, entire screen.
Yeah. And then go to the screen that you're pressing.
Yeah, press on the screen. I'm sorry for this.
Sure.
Yeah, we can see it, sir.
But I'm not able to see
you. You have to move out of the Google Meet window and go to your presentation.
What is that?
Open the PowerPoint presentation.
So basically, we are now seeing whatever your screen is.
Adho, I'll close panido. Just 1 minute. Okay. Now, what do?
You open your presentation, sir, and just present it. We will see your screen.
Yes, switch it off something.
Where is the presentation?
Just 1 minute. Our people are able to see.
Yes, we can see your laptop. We can see what's on your screen. So as long as you open the presentation, we should be able to see.
Please start your presentation.
Yes.
Is it visible now?
Yes, sir. The presentation is come.
Okay.
You can just make it present.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Just. Yeah. Sorry for the disturbance. Okay. So we just talked about this. So as you look at evolution of biochemistry, biochemistry really started only in 1900. This essentially came about because till then, you know, it would make people believe that you needed a whole living cell to do fermentation. And Louis Pasteur said, without a living cell, you cannot do fermentation. And when Edward Buchner broke open the yeast cell and took the cellular content or the juice, what we call, put it in a test tube and converted sugar into alcohol, it was a major discovery and it opened up a whole new avenue for research. And biochemistry essentially started looking at what is inside the cell. So that's how discovery of drugs and vaccinations have played a significant role in improving human life. Okay, now I want you to understand that biochemistry, it's the elder brother was chemistry. So whatever biochemists tried to do at that time to understand biomolecules, they followed the rules of the organic chemistry or inorganic chemistry classification. So the effort was always towards melting point, boiling point, colligative property. You know, they were the typical ways to you know, characterize. And as you remember in school days, we all used to do empirical formula, molecular formula, and many times many of us in school never understood why we did. But you will soon see when I go through this lecture that this is exactly how biochemists in the initial day studied biological molecules. Okay, and one of the most important thing was crystallization. The chemist said, if it is a molecule, you should be able to crystallize. Now, if you go back to the Buchner's work, where he converted sugar into alcohol, and he said, okay, this is probably happening due to an unknown compound called ferment, which we started calling enzyme. So between 1893 and 1927, a lot of people tried to purify this, crystallize this enzyme, and miserably failed. So a lot of chemists who had entered the field left the field feeling frustrated. So you will see that there are only very few people left who were still positive on approaching at this. And you will soon realize that many of them could not be crystallized. And so we had to define a whole lot of new chemistry of handling with it. So if you look at it, when you look at biochemistry, two important parameters had to be introduced. One was pH, so as a consequence, buffer became very important, and temperature became important. Like they found that enzymes work only at lower temperatures, pH is, and if pH changes, the enzymes won't work. So they observed that pH and temperature are two new factors. And basically, you could arrive at the molecular weights and all using osmotic pressure, etc. But what when we ran into biochemical molecules was, it was very difficult to strictly say whether it's an organic compound or an inorganic compound. For example, if you take amino acids, even though it has carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, but when you study the melting point, boiling point, all its behaviors are like inorganic compound. High melting point, high boiling point, not soluble in organic solvent. You need a water plus some alcohol to dissolve it. So you will see that solubility was a very different ball game when it came to biological molecules. So remember that people had to define a whole set of new rules. So that's how biochemistry moved out of chemistry, even though there was a lot of overlap, which continued, but it started establishing itself as an independent subject. So during the early period, there were very few people who were willing to, you know, focus on biological molecules, as you can see. So you can see in the slide, I give you a few seconds to have a look at, you can see how scattered it was. And one of the big names those days was Otto Warburg, who developed a lot of interesting techniques. You had Louis Pasteur, you had Lawrence Bragg doing X-ray crystallography. A lot of interest was in metabolism. You know, Rockefeller University had its own program, Harvard had it, Linus Pauling was there in Caltech, and they were all some of the key players of the game between you know, 1900 to 1950, and they defined the rules of the game. So among this thing, a man called Subbarao lands up in the whole scene. And this is what we are going to, what are his experiences, what he did is what today's major topic. As you can see, he hardly lived for very short time in his life, hardly 53 years he passed away. And number two, if you look at his spelling, it sounds strange, like it sounds like Subbarao. That means somewhere, probably the first paper he was publishing, the editors had corrected his name Subbarao to Subbarao, and it remained like that. So that is probably one of the reasons we never knew he was an Indian for a very, very long time, even after his death. So I want to quickly take you through what are all quick things he had done in this short period. So basically, he joined after the World War I. So, you know, World War I was 1914 to 1919. And so he left India and went to Harvard in 1921. He joined for his PhD in 1923 and in the biochemical laboratory. And Otto Follin was the man who sort of directed him what he should work on and attacked him with Fiske. So as you can quickly see that there is a period from 1923 to 1940. He spent around Harvard various institutions, and there is a 1940 to 48 was the period he was in industry called Lederle. We'll talk more about it later. And he died in 1948. Now, if you look at this man, it's very interesting, and I won't go into his family background, which you can read yourself, but I want you to look at this, that how many different areas he worked on. He developed analytical method, that was his PhD problem. He learned how to isolate natural products. He learned how to do synthesis. He worked in the area of bacteriology, virology, parasitology. He worked on cell culture. He worked on clinical trials, and he also worked on cancer. So it shows a man in hardly 1930 to 1948 has worked on so many areas. As you know, even today in biotechnology, each of these are a separate units, you know. And this man was like a relay race runner who started a whole range of fields, and a lot of people are carrying this baton and taking forward. So it is still a relay race on, and he is the man who was the opening relay starter. So you will see it as we go around. So that is why we want to discuss about him today. So his very first paper, which he published in 1925 in JBC, which I strongly recommend every beginner in research and every faculty should go through reading it and discussing with the students, because it will tell you in very elementary language how to do research. It's a 25-page paper. All of us who have read this paper have been very much inspired by this, and I strongly recommend, please note this reference of it, the colorimetric determination of phosphorus, by Cyrus Fiske and Ella Pragada Subbarao. Okay. This is the first part of it. And this itself made him very famous as a student in Harvard. So he became a celebrity at a very young age. Okay. Another molecule he has worked on is folic acid, vitamin B9, which is very interesting in the sense that he lost two of his brothers due to a disease in India called Spru, and he himself was a victim to it, and somehow he survived through Ayurvedic treatments and all that those days, and he was one of the lucky fellows. Now, the folic acid has been used for treatment of anemia. Interestingly, not Subbarao did it, but later it was discovered that for a healthy baby to be born and for neural folding to be all right. That's why you see in the photograph on the left, a child whose neural folding has not closed. So that is why it is called, bifidia. And how folic acid taking will assure that you have a healthy baby. That's why a mother pregnant is put there and various folic acid preparations available. And Subbarao was the man who isolated this molecule, characterize this molecule, what is its structure, he synthesized this molecule, he did the clinical trials, you know, all these things. And today, you know, at that time itself, he established that this is a very important one. And this molecule had another very interesting property, which we'll discuss after some time. Then another thing he discovered was vitamin B12, again for pernicious anemia. And as you can see, the molecule is quite complex. So he didn't work out the structure, but he discovered what B12 is. And if you will see, all of them are phosphate molecules. If all is discovered, you can see ATP there, creatine phosphate there. You know, so his assay could readily pick up any phosphate containing molecules. So that is the beauty of the assay. That if you have isolated a phosphate, immediately you know it's a phosphate containing compound. So, and as you can see, whether you take your DNA, you take your RNA, you take protein, everywhere you will see it somewhere or the other. And probably he would have discovered all the nucleic acid by that method also, if you were to sit and imagine just applying one method, how many things one could discover. And of course, another very interesting molecule is tetracycline. He was the leader of director of research at Lederle, and he formed a team. And tetracycline, he managed to get soil samples from all the soldiers returning from World War to bring some soil sample where they fought, and they did a huge screening program. And Duggar was there, there are others Subbarao recruited, which shows his team leadership, and managed to isolate a particular strain. You know, in drug companies we give a code, so it was called A377. They had discovered 6 strains with various numbers, but Subbarao decided to take A377 for further development. So he grew it in fermenter, produced it, did the clinical trial, etc. Now, after this was launched, within 15 days, Subbarao was no more. So he did not see the fruits of his work coming up, but he developed and today when you look at biotechnology, this is what we are looking for, trained manpower in various aspects. And I think tetracycline, as you know, it is still on a relay race, because the original molecule was oreomycin, because it is the first broad spectrum antibiotic. And then today you have doxycycline, second generation, third generation. It is being used for malaria, etc. Then, of course, here is the filariasis treatment. This thing, because I know it very well, because my mother had filariasis. Whenever she felt sick, we used to give this. I didn't realize that this was discovered by Subbarao when I was a young boy. But I was very pleased to know that, this is a drug given for as an anti-helminthic. This is the same thing used for dogs and cats also. And it's a WHO approved this thing. I want you to look at this molecule, because even today, this is called diethyl carbamazine, or the commercial name is Etrazone. Then this is the story I was telling you earlier about folic acid. As you can see, he used to collaborate with Dr. Farber, who is the famous man of the cancer hospital, who was in charge of chemotherapy center. He and Subbarao have been great friends. So when folic acid showed a lot of promise, Farber said, okay, let me give folic acid to my leukemic patients. They thought it will give some relief, but on the contrary, the leukemia spread so fast that those children died. So he discussed with Subbarao what is happening here. So Subbarao said, okay, I'll make an antifolate. So the first one was aminopterin, second one was methotrexate. Methotrexate is less toxic. Subbarao gave him this. And in 1949, Farber became very famous, because all the children recovered from cancer. It is very important for you to know that, just like today we are talking about COVID, finding a solution for it, this particular work showed for the first time that cancer is treatable. And how did this man think of an enzyme inhibitor, and what is its role? It is amazing to look at it. So the biochemistry of it is very famous. And Dana Farber, when he cured people, lot of funds flew in from the public. and it became, you know, in Harvard is a very, very famous cancer hospital. So this was again the masterstroke of a good biochemist as well as a medical man who could create this methotrexate. Even today, this is being used. So all his work, whether his method, which we'll discuss now in detail, is interesting. He, as I told you, he became very famous for the phosphate estimation. So to estimate, the problem with phosphorus estimation, before 1925, a lot of side reactions and low reliability. You know, the basic chemistry, perchloric acid plus ammonium molybdate, you make molybdic acid. Molybdic acid, when it combines with inorganic phosphorus, it forms phosphomolybdic acid. And as you can see, molybdenum is in a particular oxidation state. So what Subbarao and Fiske did was they identified a molecule called ANSA, 1,2,4 amino naphthol sulfonic acid. And when they used it, it converted this phosphomolybdic acid into a reduced blue colored compound. And it was reproducible. You could do that, say, in blood, you could do it in urine. You know, it was a magic method practically. So he became, and you will be surprised to know, he died in 1948. If you look at the publication, became so popular, the citation, that it crossed 30,000 citations, one of the top 100 most cited papers. And as you can see, as interest in nucleic acid molecules increased, his phosphate estimation became a gold standard for all of them. And you can see the method. And then only in about 1978, somebody modified this method where he used the same ANSA, but instead of sulfuric acid, they used hydrochloric acid. He put some SDS. So you didn't have to deproteinize the sample. In Subbarao's method, you had to deproteinize. So this method worked for more than 5 decades. I mean, it is something. You have to be in the field to know how a particular technique survived, because today no technique survives for that long. And I think he holds one of the world records as far as the method which had survived the longest. Then, of course, he did discover ATP. I won't discuss much about it because there's a lot of controversy around it, because Lohmann and Meyerhoff, there is some controversy. I'm sure my friend Sitaramam and Murli there will enlighten more on it. But I just want to spend a bit of time on labile phosphorus compound. Okay. Now, it's very interesting that when he did the phosphate estimation on the muscle extracts of this after deproteinization, when they did the phosphate level estimation, they found that initially there was a rapid color formation in 4 minutes. That's what their methods was supposed to do. But the color kept on increasing for about 30 minutes before it stabilized. So it was a bit puzzling observation for them that there are two possible things. Either there is some inhibitor which is delaying the release of phosphate, or there is some labile phosphorus compound in the this thing. And through a series of brilliant work which Subbarao did along with Fiske, you know, they did electrical simulation. Then they found this labile phosphorus level goes down and phosphate level goes up. They cut off the blood supply. Then again, the phosphate level goes up and labile phosphorus come down, etc. And from that, they try to isolate this creatine phosphate. And one of the very popular ways to use copper sulfate, calcium chloride, you know, things like that, which are water soluble, copper chloride, and you put it. So this creatine phosphate used to, in one case with calcium, it crystallizes a calcium creatine phosphate. So crystallize mean, and then you wash it and do your carbon, nitrogen, calcium estimation and all that. And they arrived at the molecular formula of this. Okay. And they found that it had one molecule of creatine and one molecule of phosphate. You might ask, how did they know it is creatine? About, before 1925, about 78 years back, somebody had isolated this creatine and characterized and created a data in the database that this will be the carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen. So those days, since they didn't have instruments to measure the structure, they only relied on this, go to the, table of data available, which is closest to it, and make a guess, and then start looking for, okay, this might be creatine phosphate because it fits in with all the things. So that was the general approach. So they did not have mass spec and, you know, all the great instruments what we talk about. It was through simply carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen analysis. Okay, so that is why, and this paper was published in Science. Okay, and so creatine phosphate, and they showed that for muscle contraction, creatine phosphate plays a major role. Regarding ATP, I just want to say only one word that Subba Rao did discover, and he discovered that it is made up of adenine and sugar and three phosphate molecules. So his assay by phosphate showed there are three molecules of phosphate per molecule of ATP. Nothing more. He didn't know that it is involved in, you know, high energy bond is there, that's a squiggle bond is there, etc., etc. And I'm sure Sitaramam will throw his expertise on this and enlighten us more. Okay. So just to just summarize what all we discussed. So you can see 1925 to 1940, he discovered creatine phosphate, ATP. You know, he didn't have a permanent job. He remained a teaching fellow there. He didn't get American citizenship. You know, so, you know, it's a typical story of people, you know, those days. And, you know, he led like any other man struggling to make, you know, postdocs. Didn't have a great time either at that time. But this 1925 paper, and Otto Follin was very fond of Subba Rao, because it comes out very well that, you know, Otto Follin died in 1935. So the story goes that Subba Rao went to pay respects to his wife, and she said, "My husband always considered you as the greatest genius he has ever come across, and he has great expectations of you." So it is amazing that Otto Follin, if he was alive, probably he would have been a professor in Harvard. This is my wild guess. But there were people who respected his brilliance. And this created problem for Fiske, which I'm sure my friends will elaborate more, because everybody said, no, it is not Fiske's work. So the fellow didn't become professor because everybody said, no, they're also Subba Rao's work. It is not Fiske's works. So, and then Subba Rao goes on to, you know, in 1935, renounce the credit for phosphocreatine. No. It was, the typical Indian mindset of, being very humble and giving away whatever they did. So it is amazing that he renounced this. Then later, he was helping quietly without being paid anything. So one day, American cyanamide president asked, "How come we are doing so well? Who is helping us?" So it looks like they said, no, there is a person called Subba Rao who is helping us. Oh, get him here. We'll make him director of research. And that's how he joined. Now, I want you to understand the Second World War was between 1939 to 45. And I just want to say here that you see the word penicillin. You will say, what has Subba Rao got to do with penicillin? Well, it is one of, at that time, penicillin was just discovered. Howard Florey was running because people were dying because of injury more than bullet injuries. So Howard Florey came to USA, had his connection because there was a postdoc there. And US government, like they did it for COVID, they said, okay, whosoever can manufacture penicillin will give you rights to do it. So I'm sure Subba Rao also pitched for it. They started making penicillin, and Howard Florey was so impressed. They said, "You made a better penicillin than what we have made." That's a comment I've heard. So what I'm trying to say is that he knew what is societal help, and that's why it's important. Later, the same fermentation facility, where he used it to make vitamin B12. Today, vitamin B12 is cheap because he introduced fermentation, and this is one of the early biotechnology way of growing and making molecules. So certainly he was one of the leader in the whole field. 1945, he discovered folic acid, fermentation, he started making B12 and all that. 47, he made the anti-helminthic, then he made the cancer drug in 1948, as well as tetracycline, two independent blockbuster. One, that in 1950, a company called Lederle, whose turnover was hardly 277 million, suddenly shot up through R&D to $322 million. not a small feat. And now, of course, Lederle is called Pfizer because Lederle doesn't exist anymore. But I want you to say that this man died in 1948. Probably he was alive. He would have been himself a billionaire for us. He would have been a billionaire. Anyway, fate, nature's fate is very the thing. But what I want to say, a man who was a freedom fighter, because he didn't get his MBBS degree because the British, the surgery exam, I'm told, he wore a khadi gown and went. And the British medical expert said, let Mahatma Gandhi become president of India, you will get your MBBS. So he was forcefully failed in MBBS from Madras Christian College. So he only got the LMP degree. And so that's how the Ayurveda college picked him up to teach anatomy for their Ayurveda students and all that. And then, you know, the rest is story with him. So a man in 18 years accomplished with many of us, even if we discover one drug in our lifetime, it's a great achievement, and some people even win a Nobel Prize. But it's amazing, a one man with his leadership and hands-on working made all the difference. So I'll just close by giving comment that some of the nucleotides isolated by Subbarao had to be rediscovered years later by other workers, because Fiske apparently out of jealousy did not let Subbarao's contributions see the light of the day. So this was said by George Hitchings, who was Subbarao's colleague. And life of Dr. Ellaprakash Subbarao is an example of how religion, because he was a great follower of Ramakrishna Math, and he apparently wanted to become a monk, but his mother did not allow. And Ramakrishna Mission said, why don't you do MBBS and you can work in our mission hospital. So that's how, you know, he was a great follower of the Ramakrishna Mission. But Inpada is the example of how religion and tradition need not necessarily be incongruous and incompatible with the scientific temper. Also, how they can foster modernity and development. Dr. Subbarao is an anachronism in today's world, which is more intensely individualistic than the world he lived and excelled. This was said by Dr. R.V. Vaidyanath Iyer, science journalist for Vigyan Prasar. So just to give you a complete story, as we said, just to recapitulate, that from phosphate estimation through creatine phosphate, ATP, and then through, you know, folic acid, penicillin, you know, tetracycline, aminopterin, etrazone, and all that, he did it, mind you, in 18 years, 1930 to 1948. I salute the man, and you know, it's something amazing. So I close here and thank you for your patient listening. Now the floor is open.
Beneficiary slides for the
Thank you, Professor Kannan.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you for the very enlightening. I mean, I wouldn't say enlightening, but a discussion and presentation of a man many people do not know or recognize. Very duly so that we have this talk today. I'll open the session for a panel discussion. Before that, I would kindly request Professor Kannan to introduce the panelists to the audience.
Yes. Thank you, Sudha. Professor Sitharaman, as I said, he did his MBBS, and during his MBBS, he was in Vellore. He was very influenced by work in Bachawa's lab, so he went and did a lot of research projects. Probably he published paper with Bachawa as a MBBS student also, and then that took him to do a PhD in biochemistry from India Institute of Sciences, and then he went to Yale, and then he came back to NIN, and then after came back to NIN, he published a paper in Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, USA. And I must say, you know, for us it was this thing that, you know, he, as a first paper after coming back to India, he published in PNAS. So, and he's very good in physics, maths, I mean, philosophy, whole lot of things. Coming to Professor Sitharaman, Professor Muralidhar, he's another person, because he was quite senior to me when I knew him in IISA Bangalore, when I used to visit regularly from Mysore. And I must say, he was the hero among all the research scholars there in the biology field. You know, I don't know, many of them who are professors today in IASC and all, probably he taught them chromatography, how to do estimation. So Professor, Murli there was a local hero for many of us, in the sense, even today people look forward to him. But he worked on passive immunization. And, he'll talk more about it. So whenever COVID vaccination came, I used to call him every other day and discuss with him, what do you think it is happening? So he published a whole, he did a whole lot of, So he did a whole lot of work on passive immunization monkeys, if I remember right. Then he joined Central University of Hyderabad. Then later he moved as professor in the Department of Zoology to teach biochemistry in Delhi University. And he retired from there. Of course, he's a very well-known person. Please read up in the net, both Sitaramam and Professor Murli there. It will be interesting to see. And I just leave the floor to them to start the, their impressions on Subbarao. So may I request Sitaramam to begin?
Can you stop sharing your screen?
Okay.
I also have a request for these students and participants. If you have questions for Professor Kannan or the panelists, kindly post them on the chat box. We will take them up once the panel discussion is over. Thank you.
Idha inga sharing screen eppadi nadathuradhu?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear. I'm trying to shut the screen. Give me 1 minute. Sorry.
Just stop sharing. Just click on stop sharing.
Is it okay? Is it okay? Okay, sorry, Sitaramam.
I can just talk like this, right? I don't have to change the screen.
Yeah, sure.
All right. Thanks for those nice words, Kannan. One thing I must tell you, Mr. Gupta, myself, Professor Sri Ramachari, on the 100th birthday of Subbarao, started a did something about what to do for the memory of Subbarao at National Institute of Nutrition. And this is the book that is supposed to have a collection of his works. Not much came out of it later, as many things happen with ICMR, be that as it may. That was my knowledge of Mr. Gupta and his book on Panacea about Subbarao. Good to see him after a long time. Now, I don't know. I was looking at the chemicals, the structures, because somehow, though I'm a biochemist, supposed to be, I was never much into chemistry. So the chemistry has always been the Achilles heel for me, whereas I was far more comfortable with anything physical. So when I looked at the structures were by and large quite simple. And they became simple for me after working with 4 years with an organic chemistry software company with organic chemists. And I started learning organic chemistry after my retirement. So the question, when I look back from that point of view of what Subbarao has done, incidentally, none of his papers have any statistics in it. Since you were referring to my preoccupation with statistics, I think a good estimation is a good estimation. Statistics proves it. It doesn't go beyond that. All right? It is the question you ask. And for some reason that I cannot fully fathom, I think it's sheer accident, by logically looking at a problem, Subbarao happened to have picked some of the finest of the problems as we see, look back and see today. Now, that it is a forerunner of biotechnology in many ways, is also incidental to his life at that came later at Cyanamed. By the way, Cyanamed at that time we approached for involvement in Subrao centenary. They didn't even reply. We wrote from ICMR. Okay, so memories run pretty short in the West. Now, what made Subrao's work distinctive was he always had a better way to handle a question. For instance, the former director at Alembic, Subbaiah, asked him, because I couldn't understand ABC of his microbiological work in those days. And the methods and what they followed have nothing to do with the microbiology I learned both as a medical student and subsequently in my postdoctoral work. And the practices, they are all completely different his times and subsequent times. Not so with the chemistry, because it's basically acid-base catalysis, stability, carbon, hydrogen, oxygen analysis, like you, Kanan was mentioning. And they came home pretty good, but the point is he invariably picked up very important compounds. Phosphocreatine with the higher, one of the highest high energy intermediates, or ATP, though he didn't get the credit. In all these, you see a great meticulousness in his scientific approach and systematic arguments in all his papers. As far as comments on how Fiske let him down or whatever, but it is natural when you work in an alien environment that you really do not share any empathy with. The people, but even it happens today. Most of us have left the West, came back largely because we couldn't possibly live like second-hand citizens in the US or elsewhere. So when you go to conferences, exactly the same thing still happens. I won't quote instances. So really the problem is that he had to be an alien virtually in the attic, as the movie goes, to do the work. But that didn't deter him. I think Lederle gave him a much better environment for his own work, whatever he did there, than probably Howard did. But from what I gathered from the readings. And yet he maintained till his very end his aloofness and sticking to his job. Now, it will be redundant to talk about, not really redundant, maybe I'll reflect more about what is how we view our own research in India, as opposed to what Subrao has gone through. If you ask my personal opinion, the best place to work in India is to get a job, because then you have a tenure track. You don't have to look for tomorrow what's happening. And you can continue working on what you please. In my 30, 40 years of career in the country, I never had to submit a project and actually do what the project I proposed to do. I could submit a project, get the money, do what I want, and the project evaluation, they were always happy that something came out of it, and that was the end of it. You don't have that kind of freedom in the West. Once you give a project, you have to go A, B, C exactly on that, and you can't go on further on a lead. It's clear that Subrao lived in a time where he didn't have to depend too much on NIH, too much on writing projects and sticking to formats. And he could do what internally the group wanted to do. His involvement with phosphate estimation was a lineage. I mean, his development of the phosphate estimation came from Folin, sea culture reagent, similar reagents used for reduction and so on. Kanan, that is to prove to you that I picked a little chemistry.
Lovely, lovely. Professor Murli, there, may I request you to say your comments?
First of all, I thank you, Kanan, for giving me this opportunity. I do not know where I fit in. I have read a lot on Subrao, Yellapurgad Subrao. I don't know him. I have never met him. Probably I was not even born. I had a my first sort of proximity was through your university, Ella Prakada Subbarao Memorial Lectures, where I read a lot about him. The next thing that happened was Gupta Garu came to me one day and said that this Bengali guy, Siddharth Mukherjee, has written a book, Emperor of All Melodies, and he refers to this work of antifolate work and what Sidney Farber did and all that. But Gupta Garu felt that Siddharth Mukherjee did not give enough to Subbarao while discussing that, and he was only praising Sidney Farber. So I said, where do I come into the picture? So he said, I have the laboratory books, notebooks of Subbarao. Kindly go through them and give me a one-page note on actually what happened on that issue. As usual, I was a very arrogant person those days. So I said, I don't have time. I'm very busy with my work. He pestered. Three times, I think, he pestered. Then I said, let me look into this. So I spent a month actually going through the laboratory records of Subbarao. And I realized that there cannot be another scientist like him. He's absolute genius. His strength in chemistry made him go through all this. Although you also mentioned that he has worked on many fields. He didn't work on those fields, not a biologist by any definition, but his chemistry insights made his work applicable to solving some of the problems in, say, cancer or parasitology or any such thing. I don't think he was a biologist by any definition. Whatever it is, I wrote a one-page or two-page, I can use the word stinker, and Gupta Garu went and met Siddharth Mukherjee, showed him the thing. He agreed. He accepted. Subsequently, Siddharth Mukherjee came, visited Delhi, and one of those people was interviewing him in NDTV, and there he mentioned that he apologized and mentioned that some Delhi University professor has written a stinker to me, whatever it is. So that is the only occasion where I think, but I read a lot later, all his papers and everything. Absolute respect. I don't think I have met or heard about anybody equal in brilliance to this man. The next thing that I wish to comment is what happened today evening. Some of the, while you were presenting, and one slide you showed that somebody commented that he didn't have any so-called conflict of interest between religion and science, hardcore science, experimental science. I think the comment is true, but it is misplaced, because true religion also seeks truth. We are confusing with the superstitions and cultural practices that go in the practice of religion, but true religion is nothing against true science, where both seek the truth. Only thing is, the area of investigation is limited in natural science. It restricts itself to asking questions which are about nature, physical nature or chemical nature or biological nature, and then try to get answer. And the method is very well defined, what you call as scientific method. Francis Bacon wrote all this. Subsequently, Immanuel Kant and many others have contributed, including Karl Popper. They have all defined all this rigorously. So with that, there is a restriction for natural science, but it wants truth only. So a true scientist will not comment on God. These are all silly questions, which, you know, I also face it when my students keep asking, do you believe in God? So I make it a light thing. After 5:30, I believe. So the point is, this is a category mistake. There is no such question at all. No such thing. Both wants truth, but religion took upon itself questions which are very broad, relation between living people and dead people, wherever they are. So it developed. But then it got mixed up with other things, where a true philosophy, which is pure religion, is only philosophical in nature. And that is what you see in Islam, you see in Advaita, you see in other things. But the rest of the religions, which I don't even call them as Hinduism, Vaishnavism or Saivism and all, they talk something else. It has nothing to do with the philosophy. They may use a theology to defend themselves, but nothing to do. So apparently, there is no conflict between religion and thing. I'm perfectly happy. You can seek your own truth. There is no problem. The third thing that I wish to comment is slightly not about Subbarao or anything. We all lament, why is that he was not recognized in the American society? And as we all know, if you see the history of natural science, it arose during the Renaissance period, and then through colonial rule, it spread to all the colonies, including India. So that's why we call it Western science. And today it is called modern science, because whatever happens in America is science. That's how we define it. And therefore, like any other pursuit, recognition or social recognition is a very tricky thing. You have to be part of establishment. Subbarao missed that because he was feeling himself that he is an alien. He did not socially integrate with the so-called American life, like most Indians do, of course. And therefore, he was probably not accepted that, you know, is part of our story. Same thing happens in any other, even in this country also. If you are not part of this establishment, you don't get any recognition or anything. So there is a level of hypocrisy both in America, Europe, and in this country to a large extent. So let's not discuss that point. But the point that we have to talk about, why do we do hero worship? Science tells us that you have to have a rebellious character, that you don't respect your own teacher. When I say disrespect, I don't mean you show disrespect. You don't believe anything, whatever people say, unless you verify. So in that respect, we still worship people like Yellaprakada Subbarao because we need heroes. And I was also searching for reasons for this. When I looked at the development of natural science, the so-called Western science in India, the first people, and even today, who have dominated it, who have penetrated it and occupied it and practicing it to a large extent, if I use some phrases, please excuse me, it is the Tambram and the Bengali Kayasth. These two have taken to science right from the British days, and most of them, or majority of them, are from lower middle class. Don't quote Homi Bhabha and others, they're all exceptions. Basically, lower middle class and middle class people are comprise the major part of Indian scientists. Middle class people have certain features. They need heroes so that they themselves become a little bit heroic. It's a reflected glory. It starts in your families when you talk about your uncle or your grandfather or your elder sister who is basically a hero for you. Same story goes in profession also. We search for heroes. And if you look at all most of the Indians, it starts with making their own PhD guide as a hero. Then if they have gone abroad, it's the postdoctoral boss who becomes the hero. And they start creating myths. This myth making is not an Indian phenomena. You can see it in British, you can see it everywhere. And so this myth of a hero comes into picture, and we create these heroes. In the case of so-called public science, it's the establishment that creates the heroes. And the practitioners simply follow that. And that's the reason Subbarao was not part of the establishment. and therefore he wouldn't have been honored. The other small point which I think you refer to is the role of FISCI. As I said, I don't have any personal knowledge, but I was told that he became a professor by taking this work, as well as a written statement from Subbarao that all this work is guided work of FISCI. I didn't do anything. Well, the truth was different. This is also from second-hand information, that when he was working as a janitor in the Harvard labs, in the night time, when all the postdocs disappear, it is there that Subbarao did all this work. He showed the thing to FISCI for final approval. But whether this story is true or not, I do not know. Let me conclude by making a few comments. Because this so-called modern science or experimental science essentially came from Europe to all of us, most of the heroes are from Western science. Although those who are a little bit patriotic and who also want to look for Indian heroes make lists like who are the great Indian scientists or greatest Indian scientists. Fortunately or unfortunately, the list ends in 1950s only, and the whole list may not go beyond 5 or 6 at the most. But if you read the actual science which was done and what happened in this country, there is a good book by Rajiv Bhatnagar on the pathology of modern Indian science. You should see the kind of politics played by all our heroes, Meghnad Saha, Homi Bhabha, Sir C.V. Raman, K.S. Krishnan, all these people, dirtiest politics they played, fighting against each other, destroying institutions and other things. Let's not go into detail. All it shows you is that there are no genuine heroes here. And this statement I'm making because as a middle class people, when we make judgment, we confuse the science with scientist. And that's why whenever we say the great scientist, what we mean is actually great science, but we don't have parameters to judge great science. If you see all, there are written books like 100 Most Influential Scientists and all that, most of them seem to come from basic science. We don't seem to, although technology is so obvious, technological breakthroughs, and our lives, daily lives, is heavily dependent on technological breakthroughs, and many of them have got Nobel Prize also, but they don't become heroes. That is the difference of our middle class mindset. We want people who have cerebral qualities, which is obvious in basic science, in pure mathematics and other things. And therefore, most of the heroes are coming from there. The second thing that most people forget is this phenomenon called innovation or creativity is more seen in technology, engineering fields, architecture, performing arts, music, dance, and other things. Basic science, even barring some exceptions like Einstein or Satyendranath Bose, majority, 99% of basic science is 99% perspiration and 1% inspiration. And there is no great creativity. Subbarao's work tells you there. You need intelligence, convergent thinking to solve the problems. And he was very adept in this. Problem with most of us is that we are not very intelligent when you look at those standards. And therefore, we struggle to do research. And therefore, doing research becomes almost a torture. Whereas doing research should be a pleasure. So if you are enjoying your work without reference to what the thrust areas are or where is the award for which area, I think all people will do well. That is the message you get from Subbarao's life. He didn't look for Nobel Prize or anything. He just did what he knows, down to earth, good work. And we know that most of you are also familiar with this Filmfare Awards. A lot of people are selected as best hero or best film and all that. But if you notice, there are two awards there. One is those something by popularity, so somebody gets the award. But there is another thing called Critics Award, which is genuine. And that, therefore, Subbarao's gets the Critic Award as the best medical scientist in the whole world of all times. Thank you.
Thank you for giving a very broad perspective, Professor Muralidhar. I'm sure Sitaramam would like to make a couple of points. Would you like to, Sitaramam, before I keep the floor open for others? Your microphone is switched off. Can you switch on your microphone? Yeah.
You go ahead with the general discussion.
Okay. So I leave the floor open to you. You handle it now. Yeah.
Thank you, Professor Sitaraman and Professor Muralidhar, for the insights onto Subbarao's life. But I think there are some questions, considering that this is largely meant for students as an audience who are likely to step into science as a career, either as research scientists or as probably entrepreneurs or in companies. How do they take home points from Professor Subbarao's life? He was nearly 100 years ago, right? 1895, and kids are probably 100 years later. So the context is very different. The world has changed. So what are the benchmarks? What are the rules that they can learn from a life like Professor Subbarao? What is it that they will take home to pursue research or contribute to science in a way that is meaningful? The question is open to all of you.
Yes. Sitaraman, would you like to make a comment?
Well, basically, if you want to be in science, in a sense, I agree with Murali that you don't look for somebody else. Whether you are in science, if you are genuinely in it, you find your own problems. So therefore, when we look at people, the rigor is one thing, which is also disappearing in education, is an absolute requirement. And that's one lesson we can learn from some of these. The work has to be rigorous. And you see that throughout in Subbarao's work. And without that rigor, in asking the question as well as answering the question, besides the methodology, there is no science.
Okay. I think you have a point. Professor Muralidhar, you would like to advise?
I don't dare advise, but I feel the question is very innocent. It's a wrong question. When you pursue science like you pursue other things, you are seeking truth. So you do what is exciting. You don't use the word career. Incidentally, of course, we can't starve. Therefore, each one of us looks for a job. But to say that how to build a career in science is a wrong question, I feel. And this is not me saying like this. I know some of you remember Venki Ramakrishnan, after his prize, came to Bangalore and was talking to all the young scientists. And one of them asked a question, how to become a successful scientist and get a Nobel Prize. So he was obviously stunned by hearing this question. So he said, I came to science to solve a problem, but not to find the ingredients of success. So this is a wrong question, he said, and I agree completely. Science career is essential, of course, but then career is a different connotation than being a successful scientist. It's obvious without a job, without an institutional address, you can't do your science. No longer you see 19th century Gentiles doing their own work in their houses. That kind of a thing is not possible. Therefore, you need a job. But then, as Sitaram put it, if your work has got a rigor, in spite of any politics, let me say this very boldly, you will get your whatever you are seeking. Subsequently, of course, you should use the system for getting funds for other infrastructure, for support. But you should have some idea to pursue, some question to ask, and not bother about so-called climbing the ladder of career, which includes, as some IIT Kanpur professor was mentioning, that at this age you should get this award, at that age you should get that award. These are all perverted aspects of pursuit of science. So young people should not look for it. I don't mean you starve, get a job, but then subsequently focus on your work. That's what I say. So don't call it building a career.
Look at the questions. Questions vandirukku.
You should hear Watson of Bell Laboratories. Correct answers for all this. He said you should have a godfather.
Thank you, Professor Murlidhar. We have a question from Kapila Kumar. The question is, can we highlight his methods for doing experimentation? What was different in his approach to solving problems?
Sitaramam, did you hear the question?
Yes, I did. Can you hear me?
Yeah, yes. I can hear you. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. I didn't know what mic I was on or off. So, okay, I'm on. You see, when you start doing some work, you learn the methodology because you are interested in the details of what you are doing. So the question of methodology is always part of your work. It is not dissociated. And we took a bet a long time ago with the students that if you are doing a bioreact estimation of protein, what is the R value you can get when you do a statistics on it? By choosing the right pipette, wiping it properly, making sure the meniscus is correct, nothing more than that, you get an actual value of 9999959s. When we could make the students do it, they wouldn't believe it. Because in general, in most laboratories, 0.9, 0.85 is good bioreact. Okay? So what I mean to say is this is just one aspect of rigor, but you find the problems, you find your way around how to swim. And you can't swim without jumping in.
Okay. Murlidhar, you would like to make a comment?
No, this is a general comment. See, the lives of people like Subbarao and many more are there. What you notice is they ask a question in a language which they understand. He was a thorough chemist. And therefore, all the questions that he asks or the language he uses or addresses a problem is a chemical in nature. And he can solve it by good analytical chemistry. Methodology is very important. I think all of you have gone through education and therefore these criteria of reliability like sensitivity, specificity, all those things, I'm sure he was aware of much more than us. And therefore, when you do your work, especially practice that method absolutely correct, then he can solve the problem. But others, what happens is you ask a question in a language which you yourself don't understand. For example, if somebody says, I want to find a cure for cancer, what next? You define it in either a chemical language or a biological language or a serendipitous discovery or some such thing. No such thing. Most of our research projects, which I had the opportunity to screen through, basically very vague questions which are not at all defined. And that's the reason when you can't ask a right question, you don't get the right answer. So ask a question based on what is your methodological specialty and the area, domain knowledge in which you are very clear in thinking. A chemist thinks in a particular way, a biologist thinks in a different way, and there the problems come. Therefore, Subbarao is an ideal example of how he tackled problem. As you see in one of the slides which Professor Kannan showed, and I made a comment already, yes, he worked on different areas, but there's only one method that phosphate compounds, how to estimate phosphate. But very intelligently, he wades through all this. Wherever it takes, he will do it. He analyzed all the phosphorylated compounds of liver, let us say, is bound to make discoveries, because the area was virgin, nobody had done exhaustive work. And that is another thing that we should remember from Subbarao: you thorough work. It is just like S. Chandrasekhar in astrophysics. Once he publishes a book or paper once in 5 years, nobody has anything to do there. No research is left. That is the thoroughness of his work. And people have made comment that if Subbarao were alive for a few more days, he would have solved the problem of cancer or any other thing. And also this vaccination problem, which I will not go into now. It has made a mess. He is the right person to tackle these things. That's what we have to learn.
May I add something?
Yeah, sure.
You can't have meetings where we agree with each other. So since we have been disagreeing with each other for a long time, let me differ from Murali in one sense. I lost the thread. The question is that he looked at it only as a chemist. To be very partial to my background, if you were to see his phosphocreatine papers, you will see that he had described every single muscle. Basically, you can't talk about muscle and contraction without distinguishing between gastrocnemius and osteotomius. They are important because there are gravity muscles and anti-gravity muscles. He knew that.
I was only referring to the line of thinking during his chemical work. I'm sure he had a big group. So they would have given the input on muscle and other thing.
No, he knew.
I don't think he had a thinking in analysis of muscle structure and all that.
Same thing for
electron microscopist or anything. The line of thinking is what you are trained to think. And you are good in that. Without any logical fault, you must think and apply. Subbarao had the greatness because he was very good chemist. Some people are excellent structural biologists. Some people are not in the sense it is used now. Some people are good in microscopy. We had stalwarts in neuroanatomy and all that. There were stalwarts actually who identified things. So let's not go into those things. Their thinking is based on the expertise of domain knowledge. That helps in solving problems.
So my quick question is that how important is it to focus on knowledge versus creative solving of problems? Because we are in a situation now, the world currently has a deluge, right, of knowledge across areas of specialization. And so for somebody who's starting now in science, what is it that they focus on? Do they focus on enhancing their skills, their knowledge base? Do they train themselves to ask questions? And how important is base knowledge to pursue or ask questions in science?
Anybody would like to answer? Or Shivakumar, are you there? Shivakumar.
Yes.
Yeah, now he is the senior person, and I would like to hear his views because you are seeing the youngsters more. We are all retired categories. So what is your...
I'm also close to that anyway, but...
you started working on Hydra and all that. Yeah, please. Yeah.
Yeah, the present day students, I should also say that some of the younger faculty who are well trained actually abroad, many of them are getting this kit biochemistry and kit analysis. Therefore, they are very quickly doing things, but they do not know exactly what's happening in the reaction in the test tube or what is the basics of the reaction and so on. Lot of senior teachers like Sitaramam Kannan and Murali Dargaru and that age group people, they have literally trained students in such a way that they have all their students, if you look at now, have got that abilities to translate what they have learned. And also get into this latest technology of kit technology. Somehow there is a clear cut what to say. The some of the faculty should also go back to the simple basics and then tell rather than using only the specific techniques. Students, because of various other parameters that are going on together with many things in the university systems, they are also not very much inclined to learn new things. Many of them are good. They are all teachable. As I see many of the students, if you sit through them, take them through very slowly, this is what it is. It is, they are all good. But somehow there is a missing link. Therefore, we always find in the university system about 20 to 25% of the student population are only doing good, and the remaining are just above average or things like that. This is what my general observation among the students. They are also not really motivated to do things. This may be for various reasons. I do not know.
Can I butt in?
Yeah,
sure.
I think the question raised was, what should be the knowledge base? Do you require it? Or can you simply depend on creativity and innovation to solve problems? I think the answer is difficult to give. A certain degree of knowledge is required in the area because science is a trained activity. You don't go to Himalayas and do penance and get the answers for your scientific problems. It won't work. However, one should remember that when we use the word knowledge, what we mean is critical knowledge. Most of our educational institutions, if you look at postgraduate teaching or undergraduate teaching, one, it is not conceptual. Two, they don't tell you what is known and what is not known, nor they give you even a critique of what is published in a given area. And that is the reason people confuse knowledge with information. And so the more the information you have, your thinking ability goes. If you have critical knowledge, yes, you identify the gaps. Automatically, you can think of new things and all that. Unfortunately, I don't want to go into this slippery ground. 90% of Indians working, they are basically replicating their American experience and American problems. That may be one, because you are a non-starter, therefore you don't do any contribution. You have to think of your own problem, whatever problem it may be. You may be on the gully, but if you do it sincerely, and as Sitaram says, with rigor, you are bound to get either serendipitous discoveries, as it happened to some of us, or you will come to the main road because your work becomes important. Most important step is you identify original problem. Don't go on replicating others. If they are running a running race, they are already running. You can never beat them, leave alone reach them. So this is what I want to anger people. As regarding to creativity, my understanding is science, there is no creativity. You need intelligence. Intelligence is convergent thinking. Creativity is divergent thinking. These two are totally different. In technological things, in performing arts, as I said earlier, yes, you have innovation possibility, you have creativity, because it is the body and the mind which are focusing on the problem. Whereas if you do only analytical thinking, it is intelligence that is required. That's why Venkatramakrishnan also mentioned, we know how to solve a problem. We don't know what is this creativity and all these things. You don't see that. You hear a Hindustani musician, singer, or a Carnatic singer, they spend 3 hours on a single raga ala. That is creativity. We don't do that in normal science. There is no scope for that. So I do not know how, when somebody was asking creative solutions, I have no understanding about that. If you have intelligent, you have critical knowledge of the area, domain knowledge, yes, you can solve the problem.
So I have a little question that I would like to pose to the panel. You know, something that is really amazing about Subbarao's and a lot of your careers is that you had the freedom to grow. to learn. A lot of the technologies that have evolved give us the freedom to come to a faster conclusion to see whether reactions work or don't work. So while on the one hand, you know, it's like critical thinking is important, but having the luxury of time is something that all of you had, which current students don't have, because they are all running against time for what's already coming up next. So given this framework, how do we create that growth mindset where people learn? Because it's not like science is, you need to have been born smart or intelligent. It is about creating and giving the avenue for people to test, make the mistakes, embrace the mistakes, and learn from that. That's how science is done in general. So how do we create that atmosphere where people really enjoy it rather than just being like, this is the next paper I need to publish, or this is the next sighting that I need to have? How do we create that atmosphere? We are talking to young leaders who want to make an impact. And it's not that they don't want to try hard. They're fighting against a system that is pushing against them. In your experiences, you've had the luxury of now looking back. How do you help them navigate that system where they're able to express their scientific creativity, intelligence, and critical thinking?
You want me to say something?
Sure.
Absolutely.
See, your first decision, most of the younger faculty today, they start by chasing somebody, some problem, some literature which is already there. That is the wrong decision. I'm not saying you should not do that. It is a competitive science. We give another phrase for that. When you agree to become competitive science, there is no time for leisure. You will have to finish the task ahead of time or beating the other fellow, which means basically limitations in infrastructure, accessibility, self-reliance, very little of intelligence, very little of what you called creativity is required for this. And so if you are participating in a game which is not fair, there is no level playing field, you will automatically be having blood pressure and tension. Stop chasing others and other problems. It is a hard thing. It comes from nurturing from PhD days. You must emphasize, think for yourself and identify some niche, some question, some problem, however mediocre it may be, however non-novel it may be. Have confidence, pursue that, dissect it properly, thoroughly. And that is important. Sitaram mentioned many times, rigor is important. You can then take the help of literature to add light on that. But basically, the path you are choosing is your own. So I believe that all original work has no competition. When there is no competition, there is no heart attack.
But to get to that competition, you have to have the heart attack to really see whether you need it or not. So it's a dichotomy. I mean, you're contradicting yourself.
No. See, you first of all choose this come to science only when you have curiosity in a given area. Of course, the choice of area may be influenced by many people, your teacher, your guide, and all sorts of things happen. But once you choose that, depending on that mentor, actually the correct word is mentor, it stimulates you to think properly and arrive at identification of a gap area or gap, something that you can fill up with your own skill, your own limitations of infrastructure. Happily, you will do it. There is no tension. But supposing I read a paper on some nanomaterial and I want to replicate it in sitting in Chennai or Hyderabad, obviously you are competing with somebody who already has started the run. And then you struggle for infrastructure, you struggle for this chemical is not available, that is not available, but I want to do that. Why do you want to do that? Remember, ideas are not something patented only for Western people. Anybody can get idea. There is no racial difference in intelligence and other things. If you think hard, everybody is equal. Of course, if you choose to work in things which require other things, Like in Indian science, for example, one of the notable things, are not notable, stupid things that we have done, we talk of Atmanirbhar. We have never been self-reliant in the reagents and other required things. You go through the physics PhDs of Indian Institute of Science in 1950s, 60s and 70s. Every first chapter will be fabrication of the instrument which is required. Second chapter will be data collected using that instrument. And the third chapter will be comparing the data using a foreign instrument. We begin by importing. And that's where we are always learning. We cannot compete with the West like that. You see the story of chemistry in this country. Majority of good chemists, they synthesize their own reagents, chemicals, intermediates, whatever they want. Whereas molecular biologists and biochemists, to a large extent, have been spoiled by Sigma Chemical Company. They can't think other than ordering. You look at research projects, 90% of the budget is for importing. Once I told somebody, you export the guide and the student, it is much cheaper. People don't seem, I know a great scientist, unfortunately passed away, committed suicide. He was importing distilled water from abroad because he has never been trained. You know, you put a calcium chloride tube and you will get anhydrous. What is the problem? I don't understand all these things. This is why poor training, that's where we get into problems. Therefore, our so-called mentoring has to change a lot. Blame the university system. For various historical reasons, there are very few mentors in the university system. And those who are in the institutions, great institution, they have done great work. They're always chasing. Therefore, the students and others have mental problems. That is the problem.
That's really helpful. Thank you so much.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, just to...
So let us start winding up, Sudha.
Yes, I think one last question from Shana. Unless you want to ask, I'll read it out. Why there is a shortage of research discoveries in science lately in comparison to the 1800s, 1900s? When I read histories of scientists like Dr. Subbarao, Tesla, I wish I was born in that century. Is that a valid point?
Yeah, Sitaram.
I just have... two comments to make. One is that your ambience, your institution, nothing else matter in science, you matter. So if you are not driven, there is very little you do. Most people think PhD is the end of it. Take any university. How many faculty actually go to the lab? Okay. So it's a simple question. It is a career choice rather than actually interested, being interested in science. Second, you look at any university institution, at 3 o'clock, how many labs have the lights burning? These are very simple measures of whether any work is going on there, because it's not possible to wind up an experiment for the sake of convenience. So that is one issue. The second issue is that I work primarily in the area of biologics and biomembranes, and I bet my bottom dollar a great deal of areas in these two areas that I personally know have big holes in them. Big, big, big holes. There is a reason why it happens. See, in the West, when you want to propose something, you create a whole nomenclature around it, okay? So without creating language, you can't construct a discipline. So the first thing they do is they created a language. Now you have to follow that language and you believe it is true, but the premises on which that language is constructed is faulty, is the only thing I made my career by, okay? The very first time we were shocked to find that there is a membranes are impermeable. My foot, they are not. Depends on the conditions. So everything fell apart for us and we had nothing to go by, and then we had to start from scratch. What to find out, how to define a membrane, how to define a protein in a membrane. Not that we have done a lot, but the point is that at every stage there are big, big, big holes in it, I find, to date. So the point is that there is a, I think one way I could characterize non-participation in Indian science will not give you much of Indian science. And many don't participate. Okay, they go home. The second is they borrow ideas. They don't examine the ideas fully. It's from the West. And in the West, they have a problem. If you don't follow chemiosmotic hypothesis in membrane biology, for instance, 50% of the people will lose their tenure in England. Okay, when we first published that it is not tenable, 5 papers appeared in biochemical journals saying we were wrong. Biochemical journal did not ask our opinion on it. Whereas we had another paper in Feb, a European journal, they promptly asked us, what is your opinion on this criticism? Okay? So there is a fairness in science and there is a gundaism in science. All these things do happen, but they shouldn't bother you because anyway you are doing what you like. Hell with them. And that is not coming through forever. We are worshipping the West. That is a major problem.
So that,
so, I think, if we may summarize, I think the
I would like to make a comment here. Can I?
Yeah, sure, Sudhir, yeah.
Sudhir, yeah, please. Yeah, before that, I see two of my professors here who taught me and nurtured me in the past. Dr.
Net partner.
Not audible.
I think
they are not able to hear you, Sudhir. Yeah.
Yeah, I think you're connected to poor Dr. Sudhir.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I just want to say pranams to two of my professors here, Dr. Sidharamam and Dr. Kannan. And my comment here is that this startup by Professor Kannan will be a stimulation to improve entrepreneurship in biotechnology in India. So I also started a company in India, and like Professor Muralidhar mentioned, a major part of the budget in India still goes abroad for importing. And that is also my experience, because the company I started, we are looking for many things. Most of those are coming, we have to buy imported. So that shows that there is still a long way for science to go to get many of those things available in India. So hopefully this-
I can't see myself.
Company can stimulate and nurture more students and entrepreneurs. Yeah, that's all I want to add. Thank you very much.
In fact, Sudhir is our first batch of biotech students from Pune University. And sometime we'll get him to talk in this, you know, because he has a very interesting career he has gone through. And he has come all the way from USA. He's right now sitting in USA and setting up in Kerala. A startup which has already started to make antibodies. So, you know, Murali will be quite happy to know that, you know, some work is going on in that direction. Okay, Sudha, let us wind it up. And
yes, thank you. And thank you to all the speakers and panelists for this wonderful evening and discussions and sharing of thoughts. I think as a take home for all the students here, three key things that came up from everyone is rigor, passion, and confidence. It doesn't matter whether you were in the 1800s or you'll be in the 2100s, but these three things, I think, will help you achieve what you want to pursue, both in science and whatever else you want to do. So please, you know, have rigor in whatever you do. And thank you. And I hope KK Biotech will be able to mentor more students, inspire, and hopefully we'll be a country that will be contributing to real good science in the coming decades. Thanks, everyone. Thank you, Professor Kannan. Yeah. Thank you, Professor Muralidhar, Professor Sitharaman.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sudha, for chairing, being, you know, managing the whole show. And thanks each one of you for taking time off and join us. So we look forward to more interaction. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, Kannan.
It's our pleasure. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. Very nice. We all could sit together and talk.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay then. Bye bye.
Bye.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah. Good evening. Yeah.